This is part two of a series on attention networks. In this video, we will implement a sequence-to-sequence model to predict time series. This video was produced in Korean and translated into English. My voice is generated by AI, text-to-speech. In the last video, we looked at how a sequence-to-sequence model works and how to create a dataset for time series prediction. In this video, we will implement this model using Keras and predict a time series. First, let's write a code to generate the training dataset for time series prediction. The structure of the time series we looked at in the previous video is as follows. This dataset consists of two sine curves mixed with Gaussian noise. Our goal is to predict the future time series of this dataset using a sequence-to-sequence model. To achieve this, we need to use this data to generate the training data for a sequence-to-sequence model. First, we generate a dataset consisting of two noisy sine curves. The number of data points is 5,000. Next, we generate the training dataset for a sequence-to-sequence model. Generate the data for encoder input and the data for decoder input. And generate the data for decoder output. In the left figure, the number of sequences in each subset is 5, but in this code, it is set to 50 to learn dependencies of longer sequences. And we save this training dataset for later use. It will be used not only for the sequence-to-sequence model, but also for the attention model and transformer model that we will implement later. The shapes of the training dataset are as follows. These are all three-dimensional. Let's run this code. The shapes of the training dataset are as follows, and it is saved in the dataset PKL file. Now let's build a sequence-to-sequence model and train it with the training dataset generated in the previous code. The RNN encoder-decoder model proposed by Kyunghyun Cho et al. In 2014 used GRU. So we will also use GRU. Read the saved training dataset. We do not use the original time series data, but only the input data to the encoder and decoder and the output data of the decoder. The number of neurons in the recurrent layer is set to 100. The number of time steps in the training data is 50. That is, the time steps of the encoder and decoder are from 1 to 50 respectively. The number of time steps in the encoder and decoder do not need to be the same. Here we use the same number of time steps. And the number of features is 2. First, we create an encoder. Create an input layer that receives the encoder input data. The input data is three-dimensional. Then we create a GRU recurrent layer and feed the encoder input into this layer. The GRU recurrent layer in the encoder is many to one. Hinc is the last hidden state. Next, we create a decoder. We create an input layer that receives the decoder input data. The input data is also three-dimensional. Then we create a GRU recurrent layer and feed the decoder input into this layer. Then we feed the last hidden state of the above encoder into the decoder as the initial hidden state. Since the decoder's RNN is a many-to-many model, we set the return sequences argument to true. That is, we use all outputs from all time steps. Finally, we create an output layer using the time distributed class and feed the output of the recurrent layer into this layer. Create and compile an encoder-decoder model. This model has two inputs and one output. Since time series prediction is a regression problem, we use the mean squared error loss. If you are not familiar with many-to-many, return sequences, time-distributed, etc., please refer to the last video in the previous series, Recurrent Neural Networks. Fit this model to the training data. The training data consists of encoder input, and decoder output data. We set the batch size to 200 and the number of iterations to 100. Once training is complete, we save the parameters of this model for later use in the prediction model. As training progresses, we can see that the mean squared error loss decreases as follows. The model summary is as follows. The final outputs of this model are the outputs of each time step of the decoder. 50 is the number of time steps in the decoder, and 2 is the number of target Y, which is equal to the number of features. This is how we train a sequence-to-sequence model. It's relatively simple because we use the teacher forcing method. Let's run this code. The training is complete. The train parameters of this model are stored in this file. Next, let's write a code to predict a time series using the trained model. Read the saved dataset. We only read the entire time series data. The prediction process does not require training data. We want to predict future time series that will appear after the entire time series. Set the number of neurons, time steps, and features in the recurrent layer to the same values as in the previous code. Now let's build a model for prediction. We create an encoder, just like in the previous code. And we create a decoder. The decoder differs from the previous code in that no teacher forcing is used in the prediction stage. First, we instantiate a single-step GRU and a many-to-many output layer classes so that they can be shared later in the prediction decoder model. Again, since the decoder is many-to-many, we set the return sequences argument of GRU to true. We also set the return state argument to true to output the last hidden state separately from the output of each time step. And we instantiate the output layer class using the time distributed class. Now let's build the decoder. Create an input layer for the decoder. The dimensions of the input data are as follows. Since the decoder is single step, we set the time step dimension to 1. Then we create a recurrent layer using the single step GRU instance we created above. The decoder input is fed into this decoder. And the encoder output is also fed into this decoder to initiate the hidden state. Then we create the output layer using the many-out instance we created above. Then finally we create the encoder-decoder model. This model has two inputs and one output. This is not a training model, so there is no need to compile it. And then we read the train parameters and load them into this model. The decoder is single step, but its parameters are independent of the number of time steps. So the parameters of this model are exactly the same as those of the model used in the previous code. Therefore, this set of parameters can be loaded as is into this model. The model we have built so far is a trained encoder-decoder model. Now let's build two separate models for time series forecasting. We build an encoder model. This is a model that outputs a hidden state when a sequence dataset is input. Next, we build a decoder model. Create an input layer that receives the hidden state from the encoder. Then we create a recurrent layer using the single-step GRU instance we created above. This is the single-step recurrent layer. Then we feed the input of the decoder and the hidden state received from the input layer above into this layer. The input to the decoder is the last single data point in the time series we have. Since a single data point is input, a single-step decoder must be used. Then we build the output layer using the many-out instance we created above. The recurrent layer and output layer already have the trained parameters loaded. We build a decoder model. This model has two inputs and two outputs. When the hidden state of the encoder and the input of the decoder are fed into this model, the next hidden state and the predicted time series value are output. Now let's use these models to predict the time series. The data that will be fed to the encoder are the last 50 data points of the time series that we have. And the data that will be fed to the decoder is the last single data point of the time series. This is the seed value fed to the decoder. By feeding this data into the encoder, we can obtain the hidden state of the encoder. Predict future values for the next 50 periods. By feeding the seed value and hidden state from the encoder obtained above into the decoder model, we can obtain the next hidden state and the next time series value. Store the next time series value to a list. Then we update the hidden state and seed value with the new values to be fed into the next step. Repeating this process 50 times will give you the predictions for the next 50 periods. Finally, let's plot the last 100 data points of our time series and the 50 predicted future values. The past time series and the predicted future time series are as follows. The blue and red are the observed past time series. The green and orange are the predicted future time series. You can see that two sine curves with different frequencies are predicted. Let's run this code. The results are as follows. So far, we have looked at the sequence-to-sequence model and used it to predict time series. In the next video, we will look at the sequence-to-sequence attention network.